2 billion hats. Now, I don't know exactly what the figures might be, but his argument was that this would be catastrophic because, of course, it would threaten the property and the lives of the Habs. And he argued that they needed a tremendous solution and that everyone needed to put their minds to such a solution. He said that failure, birth control measures would fail, and according to the predictions of Malthus, the priest and economist of the 18th century, who argued that food production would always be outstripped by population growth. He argued this, and it was always accepted by the eugenists, and it was cited by Charles Darwin himself and also by Galton later, as an argument as to why urgent population control was necessary. And by population control, they meant numbers of people. Now, they themselves, in terms of eugenics, encouraged their own families and their friends in the hallowed institutions of Cambridge and Oxford and other institutions that were supported by this network, to have large families, because that would, of course, be improving the human gene pool. So concomitant with the genocide of blacks was what was known as positive eugenics, which was also engaged in by the Nazis, to encourage through various financial incentives and other incentives the already rich, educated people, white people especially, to have large families. However, the reality of demographics of world population, as it has turned out, is that poor people tend to have large families and rich people tend to have smaller families. Now, there are many different reasons for this, but it certainly was of massive concern to social planners, and that included people in the health areas and, of course, the contraception areas and population health. In the 1950s and 1960s, given the fact that the Henry Kissinger, in his Memorandum 200 in the early 1970s, 1971 I think it was, 1970, argued to the Nixon administration that it was a massive, it was a problem of national security, global overpopulation, and again, by global overpopulation, he was specifically cited, for example, the political power that Brazil would get if its population outstripped that of America or the United States, and likewise other large states in Africa, such as Nigeria. The concern was not for the lives of those people or the ability to feed themselves, but in terms of geopolitical threats arising from changes of population, whereby other, some countries become more powerful by having more people. Now, there were also calls and a lot of parading in the media at that time of famines wherever they were occurring, especially in Africa and Bangladesh and India, arguing that these overpopulated people in the third world or developing countries or underdeveloped countries or backward countries were not able to take responsible decisions about the size of their families. The more enlightened of the social planners were saying, well, this is related to poverty, so you have to improve poverty. However, the calls for promotion of contraception were unanimous, and that contraception included promotion of the pill and promotion of condoms. Now, this is from the 1960s, 1970s, especially throughout the third world, and this is before the development of AIDS, or the emergence of AIDS in the late 1970s and the epidemic in the 1980s. The calls for and provision through United Nations organizations and various charity and aid organizations, including pretty much all the international aid organizations, were involved in promotion of condoms as a central strategy for improvement of national health in the third world by means of decreasing or controlling population growth. This task has been apparently achieved and certainly strengthened by AIDS in terms of the number of people using condoms, and also the ultimate aim, which is to decrease population. The aim that was put forward in the 1960s and 1970s was the concept of ZPG, or ZPG, which is zero population growth. The term eugenics was coined by Francis Galton in 1883, and he set up a justification for rich Englishmen to remain rich, and presented the argument that blacks were naturally suited to slavery, and that the Africans were two grades less intelligent than white Europeans or Caucasians. He also presented the opinion that the Aboriginal people, or the Australian blacks as he called them, were a further grade lower than the African blacks. He presented bell curves indicating that 50% of the population were above the norm or median and 50% below. He argued that the bottom 10% in any society, and in the Society of London, were undesirables, and that these should be prevented from having children and should be segregated from the white population or from the civilized population, along with what he called mulattoes, or people of mixed race, who he argued, along with Charles Darwin's son, Leonard Darwin, that the problem of what they called miscegenation, which is pollution of superior bloodlines by inferior black blood or mixed blood, would result in degeneracy of the British ruling class. Now, they argued, along with Thomas Malthus, or based their arguments on Thomas Malthus's argument that food production would always be outstripped by population growth. And they therefore, even though the African countries did not have a large populations per se, they argued that the population increase in African countries posed what Henry Kissinger argued was a national security threat to the United States. Arguing that it was a national security threat allowed the Americans to justify military spending and military budget and military involvement in countering the third world overpopulation problem, as it was called. In the 1960s and 1970s, the main focus was on condoms to try and decrease the world's population. Condoms, of course, are made from rubber, and rubber was seen previously, the center of the rubber industry in Africa was in Zaire, or the Congo. And this is where AIDS first appeared in the late 1970s. It spread rapidly from the Congo to Burundi
and Rwanda, which were previously Belgian colonies along with the Congo. Looking back at the history of the Congo, King Leopold of Belgium, who was a notoriously cruel man, never visited the Congo. However, he seized all of the Congo as his personal possession and instituted a system of slavery amongst the Congolese, who were driven into forests, had their children abducted from them and fed to crocodiles. They had hands and heads chopped off and baskets being inspected by Belgian sentinels. This was all in the interests of collecting natural or wild rubber from the Congolese forests. Now, the other particular interest of the Europeans in Africa was in gold. And this is where the Americans and the South Africans and the Middle East, as well as England and Spain and Portugal, have played a central role. Then you can also look at the Belgian diamond industry and De Beers and the Oppenheimer family, the Rothschild family, and the Rockefeller Standard Oil Company. All of these companies, along with the Carnegie Institutes, supported the eugenics movement and supported continued exploitation of the African people throughout the 1900s and the 1800s, and before that in the 1700s.
Walking down the fine line between truth and illusion. They argue for war, but if they'd seen what we saw, they'd break the law. But we're not the fools they take us for. Though we're walking down the fine line, whoa. Walking down the fine line, whoa. Even the church has backed away from the debate of the day. Not a just war this time, they say. Not worth the price we'd have to pay. Even the rabid warmongers wait. They don't want to be viewed with hate, but they quietly terrorize the state with warnings that time is getting late. And we're walking down the fine line, whoa. We're walking down the fine line, whoa. Down the fine line, whoa. We're walking down the fine line. As politicians raise the alarm, the people are frightened of the calm. The bishop reads another psalm and searches for words to serve as a bomb. As more people march for peace, the prisoners and captives will be released. And when at last hostility sees, the weary, frightened will climb off their knees. as shackles are disregarded and destroyed, along with the army's brand new toys. Maybe the generals will be detained for crimes against humanity and acid rain. Generals have had their day, now it's time to find a better way. The warmongers have had their day, now it's time to find a better way. They don't care how many they slay, the priest minds a congregation to pray. But there's got to be a better way, yeah, there's got to be a better way. The tax man says we've got to pay for the troops and the war and the games they play. The tax man says we've got to pay, but there's got to be a better way. Mm-hmm, yeah, there's got to be a better way. Yeah, there's got to be a better way.